Will all living cells and organisms require continuous supply of energy to perform various vital activities of their normal life? Now, for that particular reason, they actually have this process of cellular respiration, where food is getting converted into energy. Okay. And for that, there is also intake of this oxygen that will take place, and using both of it, the cell will be able to make this ATP that we are seeing here. So the ATP is, which is known as the energy currency of the cell, is actually something that is being synthesized by utilizing the food and the oxygen from the surrounding. Now, for that particular process to happen inside the cell, there will be two steps of process that are going to happen. The first phase is going to be the process of glycolysis, where glucose gets converted to pyruvic acid. Okay, so once like that happens, the pyruvic acid is formed, and this takes place inside the cytoplasm or the cytosol of the cell. And right there, from there, once this is this pyruvic acid is formed, it will get converted to a molecule called the acetyl CoA, means acetyl molecule transported by coenzyme A into the mitochondria. As you can see, it's shown here, this mitochondria. And right there, via this electron transport pathway and via this Krebs cycle, it is going to get converted into the ATP molecule. So this is actually the process by which ATP is generated. And at the same time, during this process, when this process is going on, there will be build up to carbon dioxide and release of water that will also take place. Now you have to keep in mind one thing, though this will be discussed elaborately, how it and what way it actually happens. You have to keep in mind that the production of the ATP is taking place in three different processes. First of all, it is the ATP that is being produced by the glycolysis process itself. The second is when it is being produced by the Krebs cycle process. And the third, the one which is the main product, like producer we can say, is actually the process of this electron transport. Means this entire process of electron transport chain, means the way the electron is being transported there, that particular process, it actually also produces a large amount of ATP. So all these three processes are responsible for production of the ATP, and ultimately a huge deal or a large number of ATP will be generated by this process of cellular respiration. Now this method we are going to learn about it in detail, and definitely like each and every of the step will be discussed thoroughly. Now one thing I have to focus here is, like, this process is generating the carbon dioxide, isn't it? So what will be the use of this carbon dioxide? Well, the process of respiration works in complete synchronization with the process of photosynthesis, where by the process of photosynthesis we see the generation of O2 is taking place, and then this O2 is actually going to get somehow involved in the process of this electron transport chain in the process of respiration, and then from there finally we find that a large amount of CO2 is being coming out from the Krebs cycle. And once this CO2 is released, they all come out into the atmosphere, and thus from the atmosphere it enters into the Kelvin cycle, and thus we see the cyclic process of conversion of oxygen and the CO2 is taking place with respect to the cell and to that of the atmosphere and to another cell. Now we have to keep in mind that the process of photosynthesis is exclusive for the plant cell, but the process of respiration is actually for both plant and animal cell, because every single living cell, it actually require energy, and it is via the process of respiration that the energy is being generated. So that's why this process can be seen in all kinds of organism. Okay, now let's pick up the main topic of how this entire process is actually going to happen. So to talk about the first step of the process of respiration, we need to learn about the process of the glycolysis, isn't it? Because it is that particular step where the main production of, like, that the conversion of the sugar the glucose is going to take place, and it is going to form the structure which is known as the pyruvic acid, the one component which is required right here. So let's learn about this particular step. Now before moving on to it, let me tell you one more thing, that the process of glycolysis, or the breaking down or splitting of sugar, as the term itself, it means splitting the sugar. Glycose, which is sugar, lysis, which means splitting, it actually is also known by the name Emden-Meyerhof-Parnas pathway, okay, or EMP pathway in short. So here one glucose is actually getting converted into two pyruvic acid, that is the main step, but the entire process can be segregated into two phases. The first phase, which is known as the preparatory phase. Now I am going to show you by the diagram itself, means the structure of the molecule itself, but keep in mind, you need to follow this particular stage where it is all written by the name, because in your level, the means in school level, the diagram is not required. The diagram you need not to draw, means this structural diagram of glucose and then its entire conversion, that thing is not included in your syllabus. You are only going to show the entire process by the name only, which is shown right here, this side. Okay, so let's begin with the very first step that is taking place here. So the very first step is definitely going to be the conversion of glucose into glucose 6-phosphate. This is the first phosphorylation step that is going to take place. Okay, and this is sometimes called the priming reaction also. Priming reaction, why? Because this process, it actually, whenever this glucose 6-phosphate is being produced, so that very moment we can say that this phosphorylation, it actually triggers the entire process of respiration. So that is the first priming state, to prepare the material or to make it ready for the rest of the process of the respiration of the glycolysis, isn't it? So this first priming state, it actually involves an ATP, means it requires an ATP which is going to donate the phosphate from it, and thus the ATP gets converted into adenosine diphosphate, right? And the phosphate group is transported to the sixth carbon of the glucose molecule, and it is a simple process of phosphorylation taking place. But the name, since the space is not there, so the name is not written there properly, but you have to write the name side by side, right, like where the number is written now here. So the number actually represent the name of the enzyme, and you have to write the name of the enzyme also. So the enzyme name is given in the index right here, you can see it is number one, which is called hexokinase. Hexokinase, it actually represents a molecule, like a protein which is responsible for transporting phosphate from one molecule to the next. It just has one property only, transport phosphate from one molecule to the another molecule, all right? And since it works on the hexose sugar, so that's why it's called a hexokinase, right? Now next, the second phase, the second step is actually not only the second stage, actually second and the third stage is actually a little rearrangement, and again a second priming is going to take place right there, okay? So the rearrangement, the second rearrangement step is actually the conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to fructose 6-phosphate, means the molecule glucose is now getting converted to fructose. You can see there is a distinct conversion taking place right there, isn't it? The shape of the molecule is now changing, isn't it? From a glucopyranose, it is getting converted to fructofuranose. And that conversion is always going to be done by some sort of isomerase enzyme, because this is nothing but two isomer of the same hexose sugar, isn't it? So this isomer is being produced by the isomerase enzyme. So this is definitely called an isomerization step. Alright, so glucose 6-phosphate is getting converted to fructose 6-phosphate done by phosphohexoisomerase, that enzyme. Alright. The enzyme, it actually works in a reversible manner, means it can also convert fructose 6-phosphate to glucose 6-phosphate also. But we are actually concerned about the process of conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to fructose 6-phosphate now, right? Then comes the definitely the second priming reaction, where again another step of phosphorylation will take place, where now the fructose 6-phosphate molecule will actually carry two phosphate, one in the position number 1 and the second already which is there in position number 6. Alright, so now fructose 6-phosphate has converted into fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, that molecule. Okay, now once this structure is formed, we can say this structure is actually getting ready for the entire rest of the step. So this is done by phosphofructokinase, that particular enzyme. Okay, because again as it is a step where ATP, from the ATP the phosphate is taken and transported to the fructose molecule, or is donated to the, or joined you can say to the fructose molecule. By the way, this is a step of esterification, you have to keep in mind, right? Because the sugar is getting esterified with the phosphate molecule. So this is an esterification reaction taking place or being done by the kinase enzyme again. So this one is actually phosphofructokinase, because the substrate is actually a phosphofructose molecule. So it is a phosphofructokinase that is responsible for this conversion. I have to tell you one more thing here, that usually the process of glycolysis, it will actually have the enzyme's name, usually, I'm not saying all the time, but usually written with the name of the substrate in which it is working on. Okay, usually that is how it is written. Sometimes it is not, but usually that is the one how it is written, the substrate name and the type of the enzyme. So it is a phosphofructokinase, right? So now what we have got fructose 1,6-bisphosphate molecule being formed here, right there. And it is given in two different shades, because the next step, the very next step, is actually a cleaving step, means a process where the molecule is going to now get chopped down into two triose, means sugar. Okay, triose phosphate, it is going to form, definitely is going to form a triose phosphate, but it is two different type of triose phosphate that is going to be formed here. So this cleavage stage is actually convert the 6-carbon sugar molecule into 3-carbon sugar molecule. Well, it is a it also being phosphorylated phosphate sugar, you can say. So what we are getting here is fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is getting converted to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate, which is shown in the pink shade. Okay, so glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. This is done by an enzyme called aldolase. All right, its name is written right there, aldolase. Aldolase is responsible for making into a 3-carbon sugar phosphate, right? Two different 3-carbon sugar phosphate. Now let me tell you one more thing. This is actually the end of the preparatory phase. Okay, this is the end of the preparatory phase, and now we'll begin the payoff phase. Okay, where the actually energy preparation will take place. This is the process where the energy is being consumed. As you can see, ATP molecules are being consumed here. But the next phase is actually going to generate ATP molecule now. Okay, so that's why it's called a payoff phase. And the payoff phase, it begins with the very first step, which is actually the interconversion of the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and the dihydroxyacetone phosphate into the other molecule. Means they can interchange, they can actually convert within themselves, the molecule. And the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate can become dihydroxyacetone phosphate, or the dihydroxyacetone phosphate can become glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Both the thing is possible. And when we are seeing this kind of interconversion is taking place, that means definitely this is an isomerization reaction that is going to happen. And see, that is possible because of this enzyme, the triose phosphate, which are these two molecule, the triose phosphate isomerase enzyme. So with that involvement of this particular enzyme, this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate can get converted into dihydroxyacetone phosphate, or vice versa. Okay, and that will be the beginning of the next phase. So now let's move to the payoff phase. So here what they have done is you have got the dihydroxyacetone phosphate getting converted to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate by the enzyme isomerase, that triose phosphate isomerase. Now, once that actually happened, once this structure is formed, now actually there are two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate now. Okay, so these two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate will now enter the first step called the oxidation and the phosphorylation step. Here, the molecule is not only getting oxidized, it is also getting phosphorylated. And that phosphorylation is all possible because this NADP molecule, NADH, NAD molecule, okay. So, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide. Now, it brings 2-phosphate along with it. Okay, so sometimes they are called NADP, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate. Alright, so NAD is bringing 2-phosphates, 2-NAD is bringing 2-phosphate, and the NAD is actually getting reduced to NADH. Now, when it is getting reduced, at the same time, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is actually getting oxidized to glycerate, means glyceraldehyde and aldehyde is now getting oxidized to form a glycerate, which is a acid, isn't it? But this acid is going to be phosphorylated. So we are going to find glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate getting converted to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Here you see the conversion, how it takes place. This is the glyceraldehyde molecule. Okay, this entire thing, it is already carrying the phosphate in the position number 3. Now what is happening is position number 1 is also now receiving another phosphate. So this is all because of the enzyme glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, because it is removing this hydrogen and replacing it with a phosphate molecule right there, isn't it? So it is actually a dehydrogenation process that is taking place, and that is all done by this glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, right? So this is oxidation, isn't it? Because oxygen is added there, you can see removal of hydrogen is also taking, you can see it otherwise also. Okay, now the next step will be the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate getting converted to phosphoglycerate, means it is going to lose its one phosphate molecule, means this position number 1 phosphate, it is going to lose that. Okay, and this process is all mediated by definitely a phosphoglycerate kinase. It is responsible for it, but this process is actually the first process or the first step of production of ATP. The first time the ATP is going to be produced by this process of glycolysis, and it is known as a substrate level phosphorylation. See, it's mentioned here. It's called a substrate level phosphorylation because a substrate is actually donating its ATP to another molecule. So the substrate is actually 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate here, and the substrate 1-phosphoglycerate is producing this byproduct, the ATP. Okay, and you can notice since there are two 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate were there, there is actually production of 2 ATP that is happening here. And who is responsible for this? It is phosphoglycerate kinase enzyme. Okay, now the next step will be phosphoglycerate that is formed by this process is now getting converted to 2-phosphoglycerate, another isomerization step, but this isomerization will be carried out by a enzyme called a phosphoglycerate mutase. You can see here, it is, you can consider it's a kind of a mutation reaction, but don't say it like that, definitely don't say it like that. Mutation, it usually is a term used to denote that a conversion within the structure of the or the sequence of the DNA, right? So here we are not seeing such a thing, but here we are seeing that the position of the phosphate is changing. It is just becoming a different isomer, isn't it? A 3-phosphoglycerate is actually getting converted to 2-phosphoglycerate. Okay, from position number 3, the phosphate is taken and being placed into position number 2. Okay, you can see right there the conversion is taking place. Is being carried out by this particular molecule, the phosphoglycerate mutase. Now, when that happens, this phosphoglycerate mutase will now undergo a little change. This molecule is now actually going to lose oxygen, okay, means from the entire structure. And this process is known as process done by the enzyme enolase, because this is the stage where phosphoglycerate, 2-phosphoglycerate is actually going to get converted into phosphoenol pyruvate, releasing the 2-water molecule. Alright, so this 2-phosphoglycerate means 2 molecules of 2-phosphoglycerate is getting converted to 2 molecule of phosphoenol pyruvate. Now when that happens, now phosphoenol pyruvate will now again convert it into the pyruvate, and this is the second substrate level phosphorylation that will take place, done by pyruvate kinase. Here you can see the name is slightly different. Here instead of the substrate name, the product name is actually used for the naming the enzyme. That is also like cases, that's why I said usually it's the case where substrate name and the type of enzyme is used as the name of the enzyme, right? But here it is the different. Here the name of the product is used to name the enzyme itself. So the enzyme is pyruvate kinase, which is responsible for donating the phosphate from the substrate phosphoenol pyruvate to the ADP, adenosine diphosphate, producing 2 more ATP. Alright, and then we get 2-pyruvate that is being formed. So ultimately this entire process is showing us that from a single glucose molecule we are getting 2-pyruvic acid or 2-pyruvate molecule, and in total here 2 ATP, here 2 ATP, alright, at the bottom 2 ATP. So that means total 4 ATP is being produced. But keep in mind, in the very first step of the preparatory phase, first and the third step, we can actually find 2 ATP in total is being consumed. So the net payoff is actually 4 minus 2 equals to 2 ATP that is being produced. That is the net output of the entire process of glycolysis. So if it is asked what is the number of ATP that is being produced in the glycolysis, you can say it is total 4 ATP is produced per glucose molecule, but out of which 2 will be used in the preparatory phase. That's why a net 2 ATP is obtained per glucose molecule in the process of glycolysis. Okay. Now this is a representation, this is another representation where the entire thing is shown in only like the chained form of the structure of this entire molecule. Like the previous one you have seen that it's actually shown in the cyclic form. So here it is in the chained form. But as I was saying that your entirety of the process means the entire reaction and everything is going to be like, in your case you have to just write the name. You don't have to draw the diagram. No diagram you need to draw. You just need to draw the entire flow. This is called a flow diagram or a flow chart, but with the names only. Okay, you will see that it's given in your book, NCERT book also. So you read it from there exactly. Just include the name of the enzymes, all the name of the enzymes. Okay.